Too Human was also there and playable because it's apparently it's a video game.
What?
Apparently Too Human is a complete video game.
It's not just Denis Dyack's fever dream.
It is actually ready to ship to stores.
I'm going to leave right now if you keep lying to me. I'm going to leave right now.
Human is an electronic product. I played it.
They're planning a sequel.
They are. Yeah, exactly. One of the first words out of Denis Dyack's mouth when he was doing a little 5-minute talk before starting the game, like, well, in this game, the level cap's going to be level 50.
Huh.
I was like, oh, great. Way to go long and go to the sequel. Yeah. Like, really?
My son will take up the torch and finish the sequel.
Yeah, so.
More Human.
Too Human seems kind of like Diablo, but also kind of like the Capcom versus fighting games.
Really?
It's got a lot of air combos and juggles and stuff.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Dude, sure.
Yeah.
Why not?
It seems like it could be pretty cool. But I could not get a feel for the story because it's an RPG and it was a very loud room. So
it was a very loud room.
Couldn't really hear anything about the games.
I like that venue, but loud. You know what else is ridiculous?
What?
So many.
Denis Dyack.
Oh, poor Dyack.
Let's talk about D-Dog here a little bit. He has not been helping his cause at all.
Or has he? I don't know. I can't tell anymore.
We're talking
about
it.
He's just like super media savvy and this is all part of his...
I don't know. The only thing worse than being talked about is
this could be some really, really crazy underhanded viral marketing or something.
I don't think he's that...
No?
It's all
clever.
Expectation management.
You think he's just that nutty? What did he do? What did he do? Lay it on us.
Oh, he got into NeoGAF, dude.
Oh, why did he go and
he
do that?
He went to the Gaming Age forums where, I don't know.
Where you are king. suspend him.
Perhaps one of the rawer sections of the internet as far as game discussion goes, and decided to throw down...
Laid out the challenge.
The deal is, prior to the release of Too Human, posters say whether they are for or against the game, judging from previews and footage they've seen.
Now,
if
this
the
is
game
him
comes
writing.
Out, this is him. This is literally what he posted on NeoGAF.
Okay.
Judging from previews and footage they've seen, if the game comes out and gamers find that it's steaming pile of hot garbage, then Dyack will wear a tag under his forum name that says "Owned by GAF." If Too Human is well received, all those who voted against will be tagged "Owned by Too Human." All right, so that's actually not what he. Right, that's being paraphrased a little bit, but yes, this is what Denis decided he was going to go on the internet and
start a petition,
just throw down the gauntlet,
put your forum name where your mouth is.
Does Denis Dyack post often on the NeoGAF forums?
Very infrequently, but his username is Denis Dyack. I mean, he's not making any secret.
Which is
out
a bummer because that's the one I wanted.
I just wonder how bad it would be if he had owned by, you know, NeoGAF under his name all three times he posts there for a year.
Well, whatever. I mean, this incident will live in infamy.
Nothing ever good comes from people in the industry going on to NeoGAF and trying to make a case for whatever product it is that they're making or representing.
It's like
when
chumming
Jeff
the water.
Bell went
like,
on there.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I don't think you can... I don't think it's a place where those people can win a fight.
No. It's like chumming the water for sharks in there. It's like you're going in the ocean and throwing a bunch of raw meat in there.
I just think in general, just that kind of like over-boastful, like that confidence. Confidence is good about your game, but don't start... Overconfidence about your game could be a little rough, and like
especially
John Romero,
for a developer that has had like not a poor track record, but not the best either. I mean,
or like a track record, a
bumpy road to completion for this
totally.
Game. You know, that's
over 10 years in development.
Yeah, that's a long
and not
track.
Even, not even just that game, but their past games have been like mostly good, but not necessarily like AAA top to bottom.
And currently, NeoGAF is down. So.
And Denis Dyack.
Owned by Denis Dyack.
Yeah, he took it down. This is like, I'm not going to, God, we can't let anybody do this.
And then also a bunch of people have played Too Human, and a lot of previews have been coming up and not looking great.
So yeah, owned by Games Press? I don't know.
Yeah.
What are people saying?
Did he put a 3 in his owned?
No, okay. No, I don't believe so. I believe it is proper owned. Yeah, dude needs to...
Oh, Denis. I just wonder what
I played some Too Human a while back.
You thought it was all right?
Yeah, I mean, granted, I played it for like 5 or 10 minutes or something like that. It seemed like a game that could be okay.
but also some of it seemed like, dude, how did this happen? Like,
that's something that comes up in a lot of the other previews, is for a game that has been in development for so long, lots of it seems awfully unpolished.
Right. So, like, it's like, and enemies will surround you and use the right stick to attack. And if you push in the direction of an enemy that's not right next to you, your character will move over there and attack. But the movement isn't like a run. There's no animation. He just kind of picks up his feet and glides over.
Well, maybe they'll
and then attacks.
That.
I'm pretty sure the game is like done. I don't think.
You got a couple weeks.
Yeah. Like, yeah, if that game's out, coming out in August.
I'm working
like,
here, Dennis.
Today is July 1st. It's out next month now.
Yeah. And like that, point. Like that thing right there is like so. I mean, it's a combat focused game. Right. It is a hugely combat-focused game of you running around jacking fools with your various weapons.
It's a class C bug.
And I'm like looking at that and just going like, wait a minute, how long have you been working on this? Like, really?
But look at the runes on your weapon.
I don't know. Like that game seems like it could very easily have like that kind of Diablo loot addiction, like that kind of property but to it. But I don't know, dude.
Well, possibly not a steaming pile of garbage, which is the challenge, right?
It definitely did not seem like a steaming pile of hot garbage. Yeah. I will give you that.
So that's all it needs. That's the bar, right?
And then the clob is in it.
All right, so, case closed.
Yeah.
A little bit of Kenneth Lob.
Yeah.
A name I haven't heard in a while.
Yeah.
Speaking of being out of your mind,
yeah.
Denis Dyack is a fella who likes to speak his mind.
Dennis.
So he got himself a little of attention when he went on the NeoGAF boards and decided to throw down with them. And then he has since gone on the One Up Yours podcast and basically said, oh, it was all planned to kind of, you know, shed some light on the craziness of this community and how it can't.
This just in. Internet is crazy.
Yeah. Who's doing a PR for Silicon Knights?
Dennis Dyack.
That's the company.
Now he is. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like the question I have to ask the moderators of GAF, are you going to follow your own rules with people making GIFs of myself that are, I would say, attacking me? Why haven't 180 people been banned now? Basically, he's taking forum complaints and turning it into like a big, serious deal. He's basically saying, these guys should be banned but haven't been, and instead of complaining to an administrator.
Like, so he's basically taking personal offense?
Wait, is that what he's saying? Well,
I don't think he's I doubt he's actually taking real personal offense. I think he's just pointing out that there is hypocrisy in forum moderation, which,
yeah,
welcome to 2008.
Well, like, I was really confused by his statements, because on one hand, I feel like he's applauding that, and then on the other hand, he seems really offended by it. He's like, you know, this is kind of like, you know, you're free to do this, you're free to do whatever you want, and then on the other hand, it's kind of like, but, you know, maybe this is wrong, but good for you for allowing it, but, you know.
Well, he keeps talking about how, like, there's going to be some sort of horrible apocalypse if this is allowed to continue as it is. Like, oh, something bad's going to happen. They can't keep going like this.
Yeah, he talks like this is feeding the ills of society or something. I don't get where he's coming from.
I have felt exactly the same way. And as someone who has occasionally been the target of message boards,
sure.
At some point, you have to just be above it and realize that it's going to happen. And if you feed into it, it's not helping anything.
Yeah.
Denis Dyack is a public figure, and I think that just kind of changes the rules. He kind of just has to man up and take it. And that sucks. But, you know, no one has posted his home address and threatened his life yet, so still minor leagues as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've all seen, just as writing reviews, you catch heat with that stuff. People get upset about it because they're personally invested in it, and you can't let that get to you like that.
I mean,
Danny,
it's like, yeah, internet message boards full of weirdos. Who would have thought?
Yeah, yeah, an anonymous place for someone to air whatever grievances they might have. Of course, it's going to be raw and not necessarily logical.
And sometimes that's awesome and sometimes it's not. It's kind of hard to have it both ways, though. So you either have to decide if you're going to like ignore it all completely or look at all of it and go, okay, and take it for what it is. I feel like he's putting too much stock in all that stuff and then spending too much time thinking about it when he should be thinking about the sequel to Two Human.
Yeah, because they need to make that trilogy.
Right.
Oh, the internet.
Yeah, like, and you know, throughout that One Up podcast, he talks about just like all this, like, has a lot of reference material that he brought to kind of talk about how society is falling apart because of all this stuff. And that's fine. Like, in some sense, I guess I could kind of agree or at least see where he's coming from. But at the same time,
I just feel like that contingent has always been there.
Yeah, it has. I mean, that's, you know, when you were calling up World War IV BBSs back in the day, you did it to act like a dick.
Exactly.
So...
But it's still elective. You don't have to go. Nobody's putting it in your face. It's not like...
That's the thing. I mean, this is like an insular, self-contained community. Yeah, you know? If he doesn't want to see it, then just don't go there. I mean,
yeah, or it's like, or maybe he thinks that it has greater potential to matter more than it does and all this stuff, and that it's holding itself back. And I think that that's... certainly the case in a lot of, you know, there are a lot of people out there that just refuse to even look at a message board because they just see it as just like lawless, just animals just acting crazy. And sometimes it totally is.
Yeah. But that hasn't really stopped, like, you know, NeoGAF's popularity. Like, that site's bigger than ever.
It is. But like at the same time, like it is not the number one source in the world or the number one most trafficked source for mainstream people out there buying games.
Right.
Like, I don't think it's having an impact on game sales.
No, I think it's impact, if any, is
a huge impact. Yeah,
right. You know, it's like not just traffic, but trusted. Like,
yeah,
you don't read everything on NeoGAF and take it all as gospel. You know,
right? Exactly.
Because some of those viewpoints are just batshit crazy.
And if you're going there looking for a rational kind of discussion on something, you're just not in the right place. You're just, you know, you're. I mean, you may find that, but don't expect it.
It's certainly there.
Yeah.
But it's you know. It's not all of it, you know.
No, I'd say, and actually, NeoGAF is probably one of the better places for that. But you will always get people because it's still kind of anonymous, and you'll still always get people that you'll get undue praise and you'll get undue criticism, you know, unfounded, you know.
Right.
Like, you'll get both of them. Unfortunately, most people, I think, kind of skip the fact that the praise is probably, you know, unfounded, and then look at the criticism and are like, why are people harping on me?
Right. Yeah. And I think that, you know, the other thing people need to realize is, like, gaming and the internet and message boards, all this stuff does attract a younger audience. So I you know, you're gonna run into kids that are just there to, like, relish in their anonymity.
Right.
and act all crazy. And Like I said, on one hand, that's kind of awesome and fine, but, you know, you just have to take it for what it is and not... I don't think you can really look at this stuff as being something bigger than just a message board where it is basically lawless.
No, he's... I mean, and that's the issue that I have here, is that he is giving this more credence than it deserves.
Yeah.
Like, by spending all this time...
And by doing so...
Feeds the monster.
Yeah.
They are more powerful than he can possibly imagine.
Yeah, he is feeding the machine. He has done some of the best publicity for NeoGAF that they've had in a long, long time.
And, like, it's simultaneously some of the worst publicity he could have done for 2Human in the process.
Yeah.
Because now it is tied to all these people going, whatever your game is. Like, like, people that would have never seen any of that stuff have now found it as a result of all of us talking about it. So, yeah, I think he did his game a disservice, and I feel like I get where he is coming from, but...
It's almost like a just a lose-lose situation when you're... The only way to win is to kind of, like you said, just kind of try and turn away from it. Just don't get into the shouting match in there, because...
Right.
You're not
going to change anyone's mind.
Yeah.
Like, that's the thing. It's when you come to, like, weird fanboy, like, just irrational stuff... You're not going to convince anyone otherwise.
Yeah, you're not even really having a conversation at that point.
Right. Yeah.
It's not even discourse. It's just
and to, you know, to a lot of people out there on message boards, Denis Dyack is not a real person. He is a guy that they see in interviews. He is a guy that they hear about being interviewed, to see quotes from on all this stuff. He is a celebrity in this circle, and I think that basically, you know, people treat that the same way they treat other celebrity. You know, it's like no one's out there going, like, why won't people think about Paris Hilton's feelings?
Right.
You know, why does this keep, you know, it's just like it feeds the machine. It's just like sensationalistic, like whatever it is. It's just people are viewing him in the same way that people that follow celebrity news gossip follow, like, a Paris Hilton or a Britney Spears or any of that stuff. Not to say that he is flashing his crotch while getting out of cars, or
that would make this a much better story.
It would be, or like even the gaming equivalent. But I'm just saying that, you know, no one is sitting there thinking, like, well, you know, when Denis Dyack goes home at night, what is he thinking? Is he, like, totally bummed out? All these people are talking mess about him and posting all these jacked up pictures. No one cares.
No, it's just, you know, someone fun to tear down.
Yeah, and I think that,
well, Schadenfreude,
having been in that situation, you just have to deal with it. And go, yep, well, they're going to do what they're going to do.
So there you go, Danny. Yeah. Suck it up. Stop posting on NeoGAF. Focus on your game.
Or keep posting. Whatever. Like, it's something that could, you know, if there could be intellectual discourse or something like that, like, if he wants to be a part of that community, like, go for it. But, yeah. you know.
But I almost feel like his approach is no better than the lunatic kids that are on there already.
Like his approach is seems wrong.
I mean, he's such a two-human fanboy at this point.
Like, you can't bring that kind of defensiveness to an internet message board.
Yeah,
you'll just get torn to shreds regardless of if it's your game or not.
Yeah, if you're going to get easily, like, butthurt about something like that.
Butthurt.
Like, don't.
Yeah.
Just stay away.
Just don't.
All right, enough of that.
And then Brad here got to interview the man, the myth, the legend, Denis Dyack. Brad, how was that?
Denny D laid it down. Hey, here we are, day 3 of E3, still alive somehow. I'm here with the man, the myth, the legend.
I don't know about that. Thanks for having me, man.
Denis Dyack of Silicon Knights, how's it going?
Great to be here. Thanks.
Cool, so you guys are showing Too Human here, obviously. I was curious where you guys are at in development. Has it gone gold? Are you still making tweaks? And if so, what kind of refinements are you making?
Gold is imminent, actually. So we're in the final stages where we're just waiting to see if it's passed.
So where do you guys go from here? I mean, you know, you've talked about the planned trilogy. Do you dive straight into the next one? Do you take some time off and think about where it's going? Or
No. Well, we know exactly where the trilogy is going. That's already pre-planned. We've got some other things up on the horizon that we haven't talked about yet, so there'll be some exciting stuff that way. So we'll be taking people on some twists and some turns. You know, one of the things I've been saying a lot recently is we're really want to make sure that our games are all very different. So, you know, Legacy of Kain was very different from Eternal Darkness, you know, Metal Gear Solid to Human. And then our next one that we announced is going to be very different than anything else we've ever done, too. So, you know, it's those kind of things that I think, you know, really keep it fresh for us. And, of course, we'll continue with the trilogy. And everyone's always asking us about Eternal Darkness 2, all that stuff. So, you know, we'll just keep rolling.
Can I ask about it, too?
You sure can.
What's up with it?
Can't tell you.
Ah, bummer. Okay. You've expressed some pretty strong opinions about E3 in the past, about the way games are presented there. And you mentioned the show, the show this year has really changed in a kind of a bizarre way. So, like, what do you think about how it's working out this year, and how do you think it'll change again next year if they even have one?
Yeah, so I wouldn't categorize what I said about the press as necessarily being an E3 thing, but more about the way the industry's structured and we do previews and reviews and all that. I think that needs to change, and it had something to do with E3, but more to do with where the industry is currently structured. But I would say in general, I like this format of E3 because it reminds me of Hollywood. If you haven't been to Hollywood before and you go to Hollywood and you go down and it's like, there's nothing there. But the perception of Hollywood outside to everyone who watches all the Hollywood shows and all the stars, it's almost a state of mind. And E3 now is very similar to that because it's not as rushed, it's not as crowded. You guys can do much better coverage now. And the outside impact is much better and it seems just as big, if not bigger. But on the inside, it's more manageable. We can talk about things, we can have better interviews, we can do things like this. Where before, it was just, the chances of us doing it this 3 years ago never could have happened. So I think this is a very positive step forward, actually.
Cool. Very good. You've recently explored some sort of creative promotional opportunities for your game.
Really?
You've been getting out there in the community a little bit.
Oh.
Could you tell us what sort of led you to that point? How that came about?
Well, I wouldn't call that promotional. I don't think too many people would. I guess I would categorize it as a stand against. I really think, and this really ties into the themes of Too Human, that people do not understand technology and the effects of technology on society. And here we have, everyone thinks, as an example, let's quickly talk about reciprocity, that technology increases our ways of communication and helps us communicate better. It certainly allows us other formats of communication, but it doesn't let us communicate more. We lose the reciprocity. This face-to-face that we're having now, some of the reciprocity is going to get lost on the camera when people watch this video, but also when you start posting on forums and all that stuff, it really loses more and more, but it is affecting things. So I just wanted to stand up and say, hey, this is having an effect, and I think someone needs to say something about it and move on. And I've said my piece with it. I'm kind of done with it now, but I really hope that it starts to point out that these things are influencing everybody, and we need to understand them for what they really are, which is really not very reflective of anything real.
Yeah, cool. And lastly, I'll just ask if you have a prediction for which way the forum tags on NeoGAF are going to go in about a month and a half.
Oh, I don't want to comment on that. We'll let them decide for themselves, and they can try to moderate their own little world there.
There you have it, folks. Denis Dyack refusing to comment. I didn't think it could be done, but I think that's a perfect opportunity to sign off. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you so much for having me.
Jeff, what have you been playing, man?
Hey, man. Come on, whatever. Just get it out of the way.
Hey, bro.
Too Human. Yeah. I'm playing a lot of Too Human.
You did.
I played a lot of Too Human, whether or not I will continue to be playing Too Human.
It's going to depend on whether Microsoft sends us copies.
No, because I was just thinking, like, the points are pretty easy in it. Like, I got, like, 600 points playing the review disc, and I would like to have those on my actual profile.
Now, you gave it 3 stars, but that doesn't mean you hate it.
No, I gave it 3 stars, which means I don't hate it. That should be written in the review guide. This means the reviewer didn't hate this game. So maybe that's a more negative way to look at it. I mean, Too Human has issues. Issues out the ass, yeah. I will say. But it's not terrible either.
There you go. That's a great summation of the game. Everything you need to know.
Yeah, it's Too Human. I don't know. Should we just get all our Too Human related stuff out of the way right now
Let's talk about it?
Yeah.
Okay. It's that game is okay. There you go. Moving on. No, but I mean it's interesting. I mean the reaction on the internet, which is a place, it's a website.
Internet.com.
Look it up. Has been super crazy. I mean, Silicon Knights, I think, kind of set themselves up for it in a lot of ways with what Denis Dyack's been saying as of late, as well as just the long winding path that this game took from announcement to completion. It's basically like it was announced in like 1999, but I guess this incarnation of Too Human has only been in development for 4 years. Which, if you have to say it's only been in development and then say 4 years, you know something crazy happened. And that something crazy is that they were apparently using the Unreal Engine for a while, and then they were like, wait, this engine is not done. We got to code our own engine, which is the whole basis for the whole lawsuit with Epic.
And now that's back in the news.
Yeah, that's back in the news.
Wait, they picked now to start trotting that back
out. Well, now that the game is done and out of the way... Well, I don't know. There are multiple conspiracy theories about this. I mean, my thinking was that... Someone got to Silicon Knights, got to Denis Dyack, and said, dude, don't talk about this lawsuit until the game's done. Like, don't let it detract from focusing on the game. Just focus on the game. Let's get the game out there, and then whatever. So, like, now that the game is basically done and shipping, lo and behold, there's an interview with him where he's talking about it. But you presented a different theory that you had heard.
Well, I didn't say that was my theory.
Right? I'm not saying it's your theory. I'm just saying that you brought it to me and that it's them... kind of slyly starting to make excuses for the game, what? Which I don't necessarily. I don't know. I don't think that they're going to make excuses for Too Human. I don't think that's going to be the Dyack way on this one.
But the reviews are in.
But the reviews are in, and they're a little bit all over the place. I don't know. Some people are being really harsh to it, which I don't think is necessarily. My review, I think, speaks for how I feel about the game. Like, it's okay. It's got some issues. I don't understand where people are coming from if they're saying that they really like it a lot, and I don't understand where people are coming from if they're saying that this game is absolutely terrible. It is neither of those things.
It seems like that's what happens when your game is in development for a really long time.
Yeah, I mean, the expectations just go off the chart for it because people have been hearing about it for so long, and you know, you go dark on it for a while and don't talk about it. Then you start talking about it. So everyone's like, oh, it's going to be this amazing game. It took all this time. And there's no way, realistically, for a game to live up to the expectations that get generated for it. So Too Human is a victim of its long development cycle, of all the trials and tribulations that it's gone through, and the lawsuit, and Denis Dyack, like everything that you've heard about this game leading up to it, I think works against it.
Yeah,
because so little of it has been focused on what the game actually is, and now it's like it's weird because I'm there was a review an interview with Denis Dyack on OXM UK that I guess was done at the UK launch event for the game, and he's talking about like the themes of the game of just like choosing between. You know, whether you want to remain human or go cybernetic and get all these implants, you know, is technology really always the best way? And really, you know, expressing that he felt that the game kind of had a heavy message is what I took away from reading the interview. But that choice in the game is A, not presented as a heavy message, and B, like, has like no bearing on anything as far as I can tell.
Seems like they had the idea and they tried to put it in there, but it didn't really crystallize.
It seems like, you know, maybe he's talking about the trilogy as a whole, and maybe by the end of the third game, if it happens, you know, these themes will come to light and make a little more sense. But at this stage, like, I mean, when you, so, you know, after you finish like the first area, you get to make a choice between whether you want to stay human or go cybernetic and get implants. But the implants don't necessarily have a direct correlation to gameplay stat bonuses or anything like that. It's merely just like a secondary skill tree. You either get the human skill tree or the cyber skill tree. And if you go cyber, you get access to cannons, which are larger than rifles, but I found them to be way useless.
Cyber.
And it's way cyber.
Elite,
it's
also?
Way, is it, it's mad elite.
Is it elite and cyber?
It is K-rad. Yeah, I don't know. Like, so even if you pick human, the minute you walk into the lady's office where you make that choice, she treats you as if you went cybernetic regardless. Like, mm-hmm. She says, like, oh, how, you know... how are those implants treating you? Maybe you're due for an upgrade. Like the dialogue, like the default dialogue that she says whenever the player character is in proximity to her assumes that you went cybernetic.
That's really weird.
Is there anything divisive in the universe? Like, oh, the humans versus these people? Like, is there anything?
Well, you're fighting robots throughout. And when you first turn on the game, there's a little quote. I think it's a Nietzsche quote, yeah, or something that just says, like, you know, you must be careful when, yeah, fighting monsters, not to become one yourself. So it's like, they tried to pepper it with this theme of, like, becoming the robots you're fighting, but it totally doesn't come across. So for that to be the crux of what they're talking about now when it comes to this game seems crazy to me.
Right.
Having played it to completion. Like, what are you talking about? None of that is in there. And
it's in Fracture.
It's in Space Siege.
So, yeah, yeah, like, we'll, yeah. We'll get to that. Yeah. So are you saying it fails in a narrative sense?
Yes, because,
you know, everybody's,
yes,
everybody's talking about how, like, it basically culminates in an interesting plot turn and then ends, right?
Kind of. I don't. It depends on what you. It's interesting in the context of a game in which nothing happens.
Like, exactly. I mean, by contrast,
anything happening, you're like, oh, okay, they're setting something in motion here. Finally, after 10 hours, I understand what's going on to some extent. The story. You know, they start out by just throwing you right into the action. Like, they're a very clear choice to just, like, whatever, man, you just start fighting. And then they kind of fill you in as you go with some flashbacks throughout that first mission. And then once you're kind of caught up to speed with the present, it moves forward from there. But I found myself, like, after writing the review, or as I was writing the review, going, you know, wait a minute, I need to see really what they're looking at, because the whole thing is based in Norse mythology. It's all cyber Vikings and all this stuff. So I started just, like, looking at Wikipedia pages and just, like, looking at all these different stories about Balder in Norse mythology, and it's pretty direct, like, what part of Norse mythology they're going from and where it goes from there. So it's interesting.
Save for the part where Balder's death leads to Ragnarok.
No, that is, like, Balder's death and resurrection does lead to Ragnarok.
In the game.
It very well could by the end of the trilogy. Okay. Like, I expect by the end of this trilogy, you know, yeah.
The world's going to end.
Ragnarok.
Awesome.
Like, the wolf that's supposed to eat the world is actually embedded in your sword. So I don't know.
Sword eats the world.
I don't know. But
I got a hot tip for developers. If you have neat ideas, put them in the game that you're actually making.
Yeah, put them in the game.
Don't say, oh, I got to save this for the sequel.
Like,
no,
like, that is, yes, exactly, 100% agree with you.
I mean, it's been demonstrated before. I mean, look at Advent Rising. Like, they had a trilogy mapped out.
Yeah.
And the first game was, like, mostly set up, and it failed commercially, and they're never going to make the rest.
Right. Yeah. And there was another quote. Someone asked Denis Dyack what his favorite class was, and his response was, well, my favorite class isn't in the game yet. Like, dude, hey, if there's a class that you think is the best one and will make the game, like, put it in the game. Yeah. Put it in there. Like, having played it and now going back and reading all this stuff, I find it really frustrating because it just seems... Yeah, I don't know. There are some neat ideas here, but none of them are in the game.
It could have been better. It sounds like they had the stuff to make it better, They just didn't.
So, or at least they think they did.
Yeah. So, you know, in the end, it only serves as, like, that kind of, like, loot lust. Like, dude, I'm going to go get more gear. Mm. Let's hold the right stick in the direction of these robots until they drop more stuff.
I'll check it out. It seems interesting enough. The setting seems, you know, unique enough as far as video games go. I'll give it a try.
And I'll probably play some more of it, you know, maybe just for the achievement points or whatever. But, I mean, I'll mess around with it some more. It's not a terrible game. It just, you get the impression that, you know, they had some ideas that could have made it a lot better, and with 4 years, should have.
Video review. Too Human is an action RPG full of false starts and unrealized potential. It will lift you up only to continually let you down. For example, just as the story gets good, the credits roll seconds later. This kind of disappointment is found everywhere in the game, from story, to combat, to balance. Too Human's not bad, but its elements feel really stitched together.
I'm not, like, somehow, like, all of a sudden, like, no, this game's awesome. Like, no, the game has, like, pretty serious and pretty obvious problems.
Yeah.
But
Dyack's in your head, man.
So basically, I know we talked a lot about this last week, about kind of Denis Dyack's role in getting people interested in this game. And it's been really, really fascinating to watch the reaction to the game change over since it's been released. So it's like you had all these reviews come out that were, you know, pretty negative or pretty middling.
Yeah.
So there was a lot of people that, you know, took it upon themselves at that point to start laughing at Denis Dyack, which I think is pretty bad. Just like, oh, you worked at this game forever and it sucks. It's like, no, well, no, it doesn't suck. Then you had the reviews come out and people start reacting to the reviews like, oh, this review is poorly written, or this review, what is talking about? And like Kevin Pereira coming out and recording his little video talking all kinds of trash about Kevin Van Ord, which I thought was kind of dumb. Because then it's like at the end of that video, he starts saying, you know, I feel like I have to defend this game and say it's even better than it is just to counteract some of this stuff. It's like, that's not helping.
Yeah,
that's
video thing.
From the zigzag, can't fuck with the Phillies holding down the Wild West. Like the kid they call Billy once again, it's Matt Quinn, the gold brown bowler, strong as a Coca-Cola.
Hey, what's up, man? So, yo, people keep trying to treat the internet like it's motherfucking rap beef. You got Kevin Pereira over here going, my taint this. You got Kevin Van Ord over here writing his review. You got Neo Gaff over here. You got Giancarlo Marinini over here saying whatever. And I'm saying, whatever, man. You want to bring that shit? Let's bring that shit. I'll take it straight to the streets, man. Too Human, motherfucker. So let's get this straight. All y'all going down. Everybody. Kevin Pereira, cable host, TV darling, motherfucker. This is how we do it. We bring it with the heat, man. Clock, clock, clock. Clock, 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 clock. You know how we do it. I'm not any hole killer. I don't care, man. Anybody talking anything about these video games, man. Video game criticism just got critiqued. Kevin Van Ord, you know what I'm saying? Writing that review, giving it 5.5, saying, I don't like this game, but it's okay, but I don't like it. Guess what? Giancarlo, Vanit, whatever your name is, new guy. I'ma hit you so hard, Scooter gonna feel it, son. Boom! Yo, man, I don't even care. Maybe you didn't even write no review in this game, but guess what? You got yours coming too. Yo, Will Tuttle, you too. Hillary Goldstein, you too. Gerald Gloria, you too. Everybody gonna get black, 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 black. Yo, Tico, hand me my Choco Taco. Too Human. It's a video game.
Too Human, in stores now, rated T for Teen.
Then, at some point in all this, people started getting their hands on the game and actually playing it. And you had a lot of people that were like, man, this game's really boring. Or you had some people going, I don't know what people are talking about. This game is amazing. So you said, with all the fervor around it, you had people on both sides looking to either say it's way worse than it really is and way better than it really is. It's like, the answer is somewhere in the middle, as it often is. Like, that game is okay.
Yeah.
It has some issues. So you have this so there was the backlash against the game with the reviews, and then there was the backlash against the backlash as people started getting their hands on it. And now it's just like this nonstop confusion. And the end result is that people can't stop talking about this game. And it is totally
genius.
Genius. It'll be interesting to see if it translates into sales. Like, that's going to be the part where you say Denis Dyack is a goddamn genius because he is 50 Cent.
You think he's an evil mastermind?
He's an
all
evil
this
mastermind.
Social engineer.
No, like, totally. Like, think about what he did. Think about what he did now in retrospect. He went out and called out the largest independent gaming forum. Mm-hmm. Riled them up, and then went on other sites saying it was a social experiment, and then went on other sites saying that NeoGAF is the worst forum in the world, and like kept his name out there, like picked a very public fight, and as a result kept his name out there in the media for the whole time. It is classically the 50 Cent album release plan. It is very much like,
but you're not saying that he even foresaw the backlash against the backlash.
Like, now I'm saying, like, the video that we put up of us making fun of the reaction to the reviews.
Yeah. That was all part of
that
his plan.
That was all part of, like, that was, we just ended up playing into it even more. Like, because we were talking about the game and talking about the ridiculousness of all these reactions to the game. I feel like we've been, like, super suckered by this stuff.
Like, he's up there in Canada pulling all these
exactly
strings.
And on top of that, I've spent, like, 20 hours playing this game that I don't think I like. So it's like,
he's getting phone calls from PR people and answering with them, just wait.
Just hold on.
Yeah, wait.
Yeah, like, typically, to me, when if I review a game and keep playing it after the review's done, that means I really, really like it.
No, well, yeah. For me, it started just as like, oh, cool, we got the retail. Like, I want to play it for points because they don't take very much skill or time to get. So, all right, cool, let's burn through it. Ryan got a copy as well, so we were just like, cool, we can just burn through co-op real quick. There's no story getting in the way. Like, I went through two of the chapters without dying, so I got the get through a world without dying achievements in the process. I was like, all right, cool.
And then you kept playing.
And then I kept playing it. Like, because I was like, well, you know, there's an achievement for getting 10,000 kills, and I have 8,000 now, so
why not?
Suck it up.
Yeah. So I got it. I totally did that. I don't know. It's crazy.
Canadian Kaiser Soze. That's yeah. Denis Dyack.
Yeah. So it's I feel like he is, well, like I said, we'll have to wait and see how the game sales end up panning out. But the end result is he has made a moment in time so very interesting that how can they not finish the trilogy at this point? Like, it's become a much higher profile game than it deserves to be as a result of its development, as a result of all this stuff. Like, it's how can they not finish at this point? And you know what? I really want them to finish at this point. I am very much willing to give a second Two Human game a shot. Oh. Like, I really thought about writing, and I might still write a story. Like, here are, like, 20 things they could do to make Two Human way better.
I'm so curious to see.
Because there's, like, clear moments
one.
In that game where you're like, if they had just done this. Like, I don't really like to sit there and say, like, you know, here are some things that could have fixed a game. Because we don't make games. What business do we have doing that? But, right. Like, there are just, like, moments in that game where you're like, they could have made this a great game or, a way better game if they had done this, and this. Like, there's just very clear moments like that. And that's the weirdest thing to me because it's all stuff that seems really obvious to me. Like, surely guys who have developed games must have seen that as well and chose not to do it for some reason. So I don't know. That's weird.
I fully intend on playing it.
Nine months later, Two Human sequel coming. Exact same mechanics. Would you play it?
They could just see, yeah, I would. I would. Because I would have to review it. You know, yeah, certainly I would play it. But like, I'm not. I wouldn't necessarily look for them. Like, if they just took that exact engine and dropped in four new worlds and shipped it.
Yeah.
No. That I don't want to go through again. If they make like clear improvements, if they actually make the levels suitable for four-player co-op and make that a reality, which they should.
Fix up the inventory system a bit. Yeah. Doesn't take forever to get into.
Like, clear changes they can make. And,
sure.
And
take out the Valkyries.
Take out the Valkyries.
Oh, God damn the Valkyries. I like to take that time to sit in front of my TV and curse whenever the Valkyrie is coming down.
It's not quite as long as, like, you know, if you're down around in Counter-Strike, you can, like, jump on the floor and do some push-ups or something. But, like, that's only 15 seconds, but it's 15 seconds.
It's, like, just long enough for me to, like, because when you're playing online, it doesn't stop when you go into your menus. So I was like, okay, quick, I can go look at my equipment for like 20 seconds. Then my controller would start shaking because I was getting hit, and I was like, oh, I got
to. But even that, it's like
stuff.
You have to be super fast because like each menu takes so long to blossom up onto the screen. Yeah. You're like, oh, come on, finish your stupid animation.
I'm just going to go construct this thing without making us have to stop for 3 minutes to look at our inventory.
Yeah, so much downtime in that game. All right, we finished this fight. I'm up a level, or I got all this new stuff. I got to go mess around with this. Yeah, it's problems that game has. But,
So at some point, because of all the ridiculousness of it, you guys know this, we decided to put up that video that we ran, which was very popular.
With the kids.
I don't mind saying. The people seem to like
did
it.
Did we get some internet hits?
We got a little brand heat out of that video, I guess, I should say.
Market forces.
Though, of course, like naturally, you know, I mean, I think our point was pretty clear if you read the story we put up along with it, that we were funning around with all the ridiculousness of...
We were taking on all comers.
We were taking on all comers on all sides of said conflict, like very deliberately. And then, of course, like people that should know better, like people on message boards, were like, oh, man, they're trying to start a fight with Kevin Van Ord. Like that's
we are. It's true, though. I would fight Kevin Van Ord.
I would like to watch you fight Kevin Van Ord. But no, of course, like this whole thing.
We love
like,
Kevin
the
Van
thing.
Ord.
The thing that we didn't say is that like. My whole idea for that video came out of me talking to Kevin Van Ord about it.
Yeah.
About, like, the ridiculousness of the reaction and, like, talking to Giancarlo as well about some of the message board nonsense that had been happening. And I think it was, like, that Kevin Pereira video that pushed me over the edge. I was like, this has just gotten so stupid. Like, if we don't say something about how stupid this is, then someone else is going to. So,
but to be clear, we are definitely friendly with most of the people mentioned in that video.
Yeah, Gerald Valoria watching.
we're not trying to start actual beef, but if someone does want to, I'd
bring it with the fists, man.
we'll be happy to oblige.
So
Two Human has eaten your life. Anything else you dabbling in?